Crisis or no crisis, there's a philosophy that drives me and many other people in terms of the pursuit of excellence that was really been around for a long time, but the Japan who gave us a name for it is Greg McKeown with his book Essentialism, The Disciplined Pursuit of Less. Now, essentialism is not the same thing as minimalism. Minimalism is less for less's sake. Essentialism is less but better. And so to pursue less but better. Well, that's more important right now more than ever. And so with my business, with Cowork Columbia, where I'm recording this right now, then we kind of like at the beginning of this current crisis, we got in front of a whiteboard and said, okay, how do we need to practice essentialism right now to rethink business in terms of less but better? And the first thing I realized was that we have less capacity mentally, financially, just logistically, less capacity than we did before the great lockdown, before the current crisis. We have less capacity. So while before we were practicing essentialism, less but better, I realized we actually now needed to practice the essentialism of essentialism. And so I remember writing up on the whiteboard when I was meeting with my wife, Rachel, who's also my business partner, and we were mapping this out, that we needed to practice not just less but better, not do less but better, which is normally one of our core values, but instead do little exceptionally. So we're trying to take essentialism to the next level. So for us, I just wanted to share, here's what we're doing. That's two things. There's two things specifically that meant for us. The first is that we decided to hyper-focus the attention of both us and our customers, right? Because we realized that it's not just us who has less mental energy right now, it's everybody else. Everybody is just trying to figure out this new economy and this new health crisis and all of these things. And so everybody's routines are turned upside down and people don't have a lot of mental energy. And so we needed to hyper-focus our attention in terms of what we serve, both for our sake as well as for people looking at our business. So we decided that while normally we have three different revenue streams in our business, we kind of think of them as like different departments, but normally we have three and we decided to go down to just one. So that means normally we have revenue coming in through co-working memberships, so people who actually have membership in the space. We also have a retail store. So it's normally open to the public and we feature our curated selection of business books, planners, notebooks, pens, all tools for entrepreneurs. And that normally is a significant revenue stream for us. And then the third is our training programs. Now, we had just started to get our one-on-one mentoring and training programs off the ground before this whole crisis started. So we weren't really dependent upon those. But already we had a couple conversations in place that looked like they were going to be significant revenue generators for our business. Despite that, we said, okay, we need to hyper-focus right now. We need to do little exceptionally. So we decided to keep the business closed to the public, not offer any training programs temporarily, and not offer any retail products available to the public either, and just hyper-focus on serving our customers in terms of the co-working space. That means current customers and new customers. Now, the reason why we picked that was because it's a recurring revenue product. So if we make one sale, theoretically, that sale repeats every month as long as someone stays a member. And it also has the opportunity to cover all of our operational costs. So we set financial goals in place and said, okay, we want to actually grow the co-working membership to the point where it covers our core operational costs, and then we can pivot to revisiting, relaunching our other departments or other revenue streams. Now, even with that hyper-focused attention, that also means that we still have generated revenue in the other ways, sort of accidentally. Like, we had somebody knock on the window when they saw that I was in the lobby and asked to buy one of the books in our store, and of course we did that. Even while we were closed, when we were completely closed, to the lights were off, a friend texted me and asked if he could come by and buy a planner, and it turned into $500 worth of full focus planners and notebooks before he left. He ended up buying some for his whole team. So we still made some money through that department, even with closing it, but we said, look, we just don't need to spend any energy on that right now. We hyper-focused our attention. This is the first thing we do. We hyper-focus our attention on one revenue stream. Now, so far that's paid off really well. We've already had a couple of new members join. Just yesterday we had two new members join, which increases our monthly recurring revenue and helps us move closer to our goal. And by the way, I didn't make either one of those sales, right? So my wife, who's our community manager, we talked through a list of potential leads and she started reaching out to those, and then I focused on other projects. And so she was able to do that, which is awesome. So the second thing we chose to do is to build relationships and focus on relationships. I think every business should be doing this right now, which is that recognizing that your customers, your target customer, has a lot of problems right now. They're feeling alone and scared, and there's so much uncertainty. And if you can just connect them Right now, everybody's hungry for it. And we saw this right away where we just created a free Slack community and we sent it to a few friends in town and we said, hey, our mission at Coworking Columbia has always been to help Columbia's entrepreneurs build thriving businesses. Well, right now that looks different than it did 2 months ago, 3 months ago, but that's still our mission. So we created this free pop-up Slack community. So please jump on in there and join us. And here's a link to do so, coworkcolumbia.com/Slack. So right away, we told some people, they told some other people, and we had several dozen. These are business owners who actually own physical brick and mortar businesses in Columbia who joined. No ad spend, you know, anything like that, but these were actually our target customers for our business. So we were able to connect them and they started sending us thank you messages just to say, thank you for putting this together. You know, we all want to help and work together. People started sharing resources in terms of like, hey, you know, the visitor center is featuring local businesses that are open, even partially open. So submit your information here. Everybody is helping each other out. So we didn't really have a business plan attached to that, right? We just knew we wanted to help. And we saw this as a way that we could do that. So what, if you have clarity in your target customer and who they are, then what they need, then that's something you could do as well. That's why it's so important to get clear on who you're actually trying to serve. So we knew Columbia's entrepreneurs needed a way to connect with each other, to support each other in this weird time. So we created that, and already, I mean, that was we could go today, actually, as I'm recording this, that we created that group. We've had great engagement in there. We haven't tried to sell anything or anything like that. We've just been trying to offer and help people. And I just had my former boss reach out to me. And so this was the owner of the local Chick-fil-A. So I haven't worked for him in years, several years. But I used to be the training director for Chick-fil-A locally. So he reached out to me and he said, hey, and he's been following along, by the way, and he's in that Slack group. He said, I want to help local entrepreneurs and give back. And I love what you're doing. Can I buy 4 memberships to the coworking space? And can we give them away to an entrepreneur who needs access to those resources? Yes. So I'm excited about that. And we haven't even, you know, figured out exactly how we're going to do that. We'll probably have some sort of application form for people and present it as a scholarship sponsored by Chick-fil-A. But this was really just not an advertising thing for Caleb either. It was just him reaching out to say, hey, I want to help and I can see what you're doing. So the first thing we decided to do was to hyper-focus our attention, to do not just less but better, but to do little exceptionally. And the second was to build relationships, is to focus on just connecting our customers to each other and to resources and encouraging everyone to pitch in. And it was very easy for us to do. I mean, we're using a free Slack account. You know, it's we would just send a couple emails, but we've already built a good relationship, which I believe will turn into good business in the future. If you found this video helpful, this is me just sharing, like, here's a couple things we're doing in our business to pivot. But I'm doing this because I want it to be helpful for you. So if you found this to be helpful, please let me know. You can do that by leaving a comment, but you can also do that by just giving a thumbs up and subscribing to my channel. There's a link up here somewhere to subscribe. To make sure you do that, because I'm going to be creating more videos like this on just how I'm adapting my business to the crisis, to the new economy, in the hope that it's helpful for you as well. So keep up the good work. Probably going to take all of that out. So build community. So how's it going? People stop by to wave. I mean, talking to myself looking at a window is a little odd, granted, but back to you. Keep up the good work.